Yes, community action was taking effect. The survey had brought out important facts. 6,000 jobs held by men could be done by women. Industry had opened a host of jobs available for women in Dayton now. On the strength of this, a woman's committee walked the streets and knocked on the doors. Every woman in 3,000 Dayton homes was interviewed. Did you know there are all sorts of interesting war jobs open for women right away? Three women on your block say they'd get a war job if their neighbor did. How about you? Some answered yes, some no, some maybe. On a poll sampling basis, 10,000 said they were available. 7,000 said yes, part-time. 9,000 said maybe. Most of those who said maybe had a reason. But the community knew about that, was planning to meet that. 11 day nurseries, more to follow. Here, women can leave their children while they work, confident of the best of care in the most pleasant of surroundings. More statistics for Americans. The more day nurseries, the more women for war work, the less labor shortage. With sufficient child care nurseries as their answer to women with small children, Dayton's Emergency Committee and its local Management Labor Committee went to work. They were determined no woman should cash a check, board a bus, see a movie, or walk down the street without getting acquainted with the idea that she was needed. Each week they printed a pamphlet called The War Worker. This listed all jobs open to women and men, from assistant chemists to machine operators to lens grinders to conductorettes. And if a woman went into a bank, a woman stepped into a grocery, if a girl hopped a bus, if a girl went to the theater, she bumped into the war worker. Every medium of publicity was used. Motion pictures were made of Dayton women at work in war factories. These films were shown in Dayton theaters, wedged in between features and shorts.
Dayton women are marching to war. Women are driving the buses that carry war workers to their jobs. Women are doing their part in keeping wartime Dayton supplied with clean laundry. Women are preparing and serving the food for the hungry war workers. Yes, in every essential wartime activity, in the factories and at the airfields, Dayton women are helping to keep the wheels of industry turning. And hundreds of these women have never worked before at such jobs. But the War Manpower Commission says at least 12,000 more Dayton women are needed to fill the shoes of the men who have gone to war.
The Dayton radio stations took their mics to the assembly lines and interviewed the women, young and old, who were fighting on the production battlefields of America.
Tell me, Mrs. Bradley, how do you like working in a factory?
Well, right now, there isn't anything I'd like better.
How does your husband feel about it?
He feels fine about it. Every evening, when I come home, I get an extra kiss.
And all over the city, new eye marks of a community at war. Every month, 36 billboards, which used to prate of nylon and bedroom slippers and lingerie, now spoke another language. Advertisements popped up in the papers. Dayton women had gone to war before, but now 700 women a month, not normally in the labor market, are applying for war jobs. Dayton was finding a new pride in itself. The prestige of war work was being hammered home. Women who went out to fight on the production lines were gaining the city's respect. So did Dayton's program get underway. The community had begun to search out undeveloped sources of labor supply. Workers are being hired for what they can contribute, not disqualified because of irrelevant infirmities. Here in Dayton, deaf mutes cleaning segments of bifocal lenses. Blind workers, crippled workers, older workers. Part-time workers from hitherto unthought-of groups. In Dayton, many members of the Junior Association of Commerce marched to the USES and volunteered for 4 hours of part-time work every day. High school schedules were rearranged for students who would take part-time jobs. Yes, people from within Dayton are being enlisted. The Employment Stabilization Plan of the War Manpower Commission had been in operation since the beginning of the year. New controls have been added. All male workers clear through the United States Employment Service. Certain occupations are reserved for women alone. Free movement from less essential to essential employment is being encouraged. Many hands in the community are transferring from peacetime luxury work to wartime critical work. And as with the other groups acquiring a sense of community responsibility, here labor played its full share, gave its wholehearted cooperation. And to forestall indecision, to bring the employment office to the prospective worker, representatives of plants on the priority list moved into the USES and hired applicants right on the spot. Some measures designed to find workers, some to utilize, some to retain, some common to all three. Common to all workers is the sheer matter of how to live in a community. In Dayton, it was found that 100,000 war workers had only 3 hours a week to shop. Thus, other hours that should have been spent at work were taken off to obtain the very necessities of life. With people not in war work having the advantage of regular shopping hours, a blow was being given to the morale of war workers, to the importance of war work. Dayton faced this with courage and aggressive leadership. To gain full support for the War Manpower Program, the Emergency Committee did a little explaining, a little cajoling, a little persuading. Yes, this is now Dayton on a Monday night or a Wednesday night. A one-shift town adjusting itself to a three-shift tempo. The retail stores are open. The 5 and 10 is open. The markets are open. The department stores are open. Retailers are able to hire high school girls working part-time as sales ladies, thus finding it easier to go back to their 1940 employment levels. With no inconvenience to the stores, essential shopping needs of the community are being met. The banks are open. Some companies send groups of late shift workers down in buses to cash their checks. And girls who had no time for permanence, unless they took time off from work, are now being made beautiful at night. That goes for the men, too. And there's the important item of recreation and relaxation. Entertainment of the men on the fighting front is a must for fighting morale. It's been found true back home. In the movies and bowling alleys and special dances, at odd hours for odd shifts, a potential is recaptured and built up, a potential of ultimate production back at the workbenches. The sheer matter of where to live presents a formidable problem in Dayton. Rooms, beds, floor space, all jam-packed, overflowing.